Hey folks, when it comes to applying finish to your woodworking project, there's several different ways you can actually get the finish onto the project. And today we want to talk about something that's extremely simple and oftentimes looked at or maybe seems a little bit more difficult than what it is. And that is to use a gravity-fed HVLP gun with a just regular compressor. This is a method that's easily accessible and just about everybody can do this. It's not crazy difficult to do. So who I have with me today is Matt Lane. He's got a YouTube woodworking channel, but he's also outside the woodworking world. He's been applying finishes to cars for the past
10 years.
Past 10 years or yeah. So he's a professional auto body sprayer. So we're going to walk you through a couple things, the equipment, gun setup, and technique, and hopefully you'll have a little bit better idea of just how easy this is to do. All right, so first up, let's talk about the equipment. There's obviously two essentials here, a gun and a compressor. So as far as a compressor, what are our requirements and what can't we use?
Well, you're probably not going to be able to use something as small as like the little pancake compressors because it's just not enough volume. And most of them don't push enough CFM, which is the amount of airflow to be able to spray, unless you're doing like really small projects. I don't think it's feasible for a compressor that small. So you're at least going to need sort of a mid-level compressor, which really is not that expensive. I mean, if you look at places like Harbor Freight and stuff like that, you can pick up a decent sized little compressor to spray for really not too much.
So I've got a little Campbell Hausfeld, little small like portable compressor for brad nails and stuff like that. That particular compressor wouldn't keep up, but the main compressor that I have here in the shop, it's a little bit bigger. And it's a, I don't know the exact CFM rating, but it's a 5 horsepower, 20 gallon compressor, and it should be able to do the job just fine.
Yeah, and a lot of it is like what you just said, 20 gallons. So it might, you know, the CFMs probably aren't great, but it's got enough reserve where, you know, you can get, if you're spraying a finish across a tabletop, you're going to want to be able to get all the way across without dropping so much air pressure that it's splattering on you on the end.
Right. So as far as the spray guns themselves, this is my $50 entry level, you know, spray setup. And I see you brought a couple really nice guns. The necessity, what's the difference, you know, how you're using it?
Yeah, a lot of it is relative to what you're doing, what you're spraying. So the only reason why you would really need a more high-end, more well-machined spray gun like that is if you're spraying like a pearl or a metallic, something like in the automotive world. Whereas if you're just going to spray a simple film finish,
like a polyurethane or a lacquer, you know, something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, no doubt. Because all you're really trying to do is get a nice even film finish. So an entry-level gun like this will do the job just fine.
So woodworking, you know, those guns would probably perform really, really well, but this one will get the job done just as good for just woodworking stuff.
Exactly, because you're not spraying some overly complicated finish that has to be sprayed super even. So
Right. Setting up the gun, I see the one I have is, the controls are in slightly different locations, but the concept is pretty much the same.
Yeah, you've got three basic settings on most all guns, and these are the main things that need to be right anytime before you get started spraying a project.
So it's, if I'm not mistaken, it's just the fan pattern, the flow, how much material is actually being released from the gun, and the input air pressure?
That's right, yeah.
That's right.
All right, so the three basic adjustments are just what I said earlier. You got the fan pattern here at the top, your fluid control knob is this one right here, and on this one, what's different than some other guns is it has sort of a built-in pressure regulator here where other guns may have it at the bottom. You just leave this wide open and make your pressure setting down here at your gauge on the bottom. As far as fluid goes, you want to leave it all the way open because that's usually at least what I do, because you can always feather the amount of material that you're putting out by just how far back you pull the trigger. So if you open it all the way up, as far as you can get it, and the best way to set it is to turn it back in until you feel it moving the trigger outwards. And once you feel that, that's as far open as it's going to be. And that's pretty much the way I like to leave it. So first things first, the biggest thing that seems to stop people up when it comes to this is the amount of air pressure. Well, when you get a gun, most of them have a suggested pressure that comes with it, but that's really relative to what kind of setup you got. That's for the optimum setup. So, which, you know, most shops probably aren't going to have. You're not going to have that, you know, 50 foot of 3/8 line at so-and-so drop and, you know, however much CFM. Really, all you need is enough air pressure to get it out of the gun and to make it atomize properly. And it's pretty easy to set up by just starting all the way empty and slowly working your way up with it. And you can see, like that right there, is at about 5 psi on this setup, and that's already enough to break this up. Obviously, this is water, so it's super thin, but that's already enough to make it spray out properly and not splatter onto the paper. So that's enough air pressure to get out what I need. I don't need any more air pressure than that, because if I turn it up any higher, it's just going to be overspray going everywhere. The fan pattern is the next thing you want to set. I turn it all the way down. You can see right there, it's a straight stream. You obviously don't want that. You want to open it up a little farther. And you can open it up as far as you like. The main thing to remember is you want to try to get a nice, even spray pattern. And it's pretty easy to test that by using some water in your gun and spraying it on something like a piece of paper or just wherever you can see it. You can see I got a nice consistent pattern here to start spraying with. All right, so a common mistake, we'll go back to fan pattern here. A common mistake that a lot of guys want to do is choke the fan pattern down small, just like that. The only problem with that is it puts more material in a smaller amount of space, which is going to make it a lot harder to be consistent. You can get the same look by opening your fan pattern and having a proper pattern and just overlapping more. So when you spray it, try to overlap by about 50% each time you make a pass with a gun. Because if you've got it, you can see how wrinkled the paper is here and how much more wet that was versus this. And the problem is, on most wood finishes, or you know, finishes you'd put on a wood project, you don't really want some thick film build. And so if you spray it on with a bigger pattern, it's obviously going to atomize it or break it down much better and make a nicer, more even coat. That way it protects you from having that sort of thick build-up plasticky look that most woodworkers try to avoid. Okay, so one other common problem that I see a lot of guys, or a common mistake, I guess I should say, that I see a lot of guys make is they want to stop and start inside the actual panel that they're spraying. And the problem with that is once you stop and you hesitate for a second, you're getting a lot more buildup on the two ends. So a common thing to remember is anytime you're spraying a panel, just remember to move past your project. See, once I move past it, then I know I don't have to worry about stopping and starting and getting any buildup on the two edges of the project.
So like I said, spraying finishes is a lot easier than it may seem. It's more of a familiarity kind of thing. So get your equipment out there with some paper, cardboard, anything you've got, put some water in it, and just get familiar with the equipment. He's been spraying finishes for 10 years on cars. You don't need a ton of experience to do this at all. Anybody can do this. So anyway, if you're interested in more details, he put together a longer website article with more of the equipment and stuff.
Yeah, like different fluid tip sizes, what you would need for different types of finishes, and how you would need to go about reducing them, and maybe a few other ins and outs that we didn't get covered in this video. But the main thing is, guys, we're hoping to get you guys a little more confidence to feel like you can go out in your shop and spray, because like Jay just said, this is easy, man. This is not a hard process. If you ever get used to being able to spray a finish on a project, you'll never go back to the other way of having to brush it on, because you can get such a more consistent and better looking finish and way faster.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the key thing. It's fast and convenient, and it's just my preferred method whenever possible. But anyway, if you're not familiar with Matt's channel, he's got a YouTube channel, makes all kinds of nice woodworking projects. I'll leave a link down below to check that out, as well as the website article I just mentioned, going in a little bit more detail. So be sure to check those links out, subscribe to his channel, and thanks for watching. You guys take care, and have a great day.
See you guys.